Today, actually, I must welcome Dr. Rashmi Rai, assistant professor of geography in the Gangadhar University, Sambalpur. Madam was there earlier yesterday. She was there discussing on community linkage on disaster management. So today we are having subsequent, or you could say a sequential part of this disaster management program. Tomorrow, what we have learned, it is some kind of pre-disaster or during the disaster conditions we are supposed to learn or teach. Today, we are having the post-disaster condition. We are supposed to go through recovery, rehabilitation, and reconstruction or development. So hopefully, everyone will be comfortable with the pattern of discussion with the slides. And if anyone has any query, they can write in the chat box and we can have a discussion, little discussion after this completion of presenters, what you called presentation. I must also welcome and have a very warm welcome to Dr. Rashmi Rai, the presenter, my team members, the coordinating team, Mr. Vignesh Raut from Master of Arts in Public Administration, who is making a technical support from both the end. Now I would like to welcome Dr. Rashmi Rai. Madam, please start your session.
Good morning. Today's session will be on recovery, rehabilitation, and development, which is at the heart of disaster recovery phase. The rehabilitation and reconstruction activities which follow the disaster response stage aim at achieving long-term recovery. Means it is a very significant stage in the disaster management cycle, actually, as this is when the support of governmental and NGOs, non-governmental agencies in the disaster aftermath usually starts receding and the affected community has to fend for itself. At this stage, the role of the community and self-help groups become paramount, since they can make or mark the crucial link between disaster response and disaster recovery. It also needs to be kept in view that the entire rehabilitation and reconstruction processes has to be attuned towards developmental goals. Unless we understand the relationship between recovery and development, issues and challenges facing the rehabilitation and reconstruction. Yes, sir.
Madam, you can scroll down this presentation.
Actually,
also.
Sir, I am giving a
presentation.
Actually, sir, I'm giving an introductory part. Unless we understand the relationship between recovery and development, issues and challenges facing the rehabilitation and reconstruction process cannot be met. So, in this session, we will examine the pertinent issues of disasters and development, which will throw light on the concept and principles of rehabilitation and reconstruction as well, that must make way for larger disaster recovery process. So we will go through these points. First, disaster recovery and interrelated meanings, concepts of rehabilitation after a disaster, types of rehabilitation, guiding principles of rehabilitation, and then we will see the interlinkages between recovery and development. So first we will go through the disaster recovery and interrelated meanings. So disaster recovery is basically having three distinct but interrelated meanings. First, it is a goal that involves the restoration of normal activities of community that were disrupted by disaster. Means goal is what? The restoration of normal activities of community. And second, it is a phase of the emergency management cycle, phase of emergency management cycle that begins with stabilization of disaster conditions, means disaster stabilization of the disaster condition, and end with the community has returned to its normal routines. And third, it is a process of returning to normal routine life. We will see in the figure the three distinct but interrelated meaning of disaster recovery. As I had discussed, that goal is restoration of normal community activities and stabilization of disaster condition will be a phase, and the process will be the returning to the normal routines life. Now we will discuss the concept of rehabilitation. So rehabilitation, as we all know, that disaster recovery stage in the disaster management cycle falls between the disaster response phase and the overall development phase. Means it involves the restoring local services related to the provision of immediate needs. Means it implies a systematic return to pre-disaster status. What was the pre-disaster status? It implies a systematic return to that. It refers to the actions taken in the aftermath of the disaster to enable basic services to resume functioning, assist victims' self-help efforts to repair not only physical damage but restore community facilities, revive economic activities, and provide support for the psychological or psychosocial and social well-being of the survivors. Rehabilitation focuses on enabling the affected population to resume more or less normal patterns of life. And it may be considered as a transitional phase between immediate relief and major long-term development goals. You can see the processes involved in the rehabilitation. It has four processes involved in it. First is repairing physical damage. We will discuss in the later slides. Restoring community facilities, which was there like Anganwadi, self-help groups, and CRES. And reviving economic activities. What were the economic activities in pre-disaster condition? And that economic activities is revived in the process of rehabilitation, providing support for the psychological and social well-being of the survivors. We always ignore the psychological well-being or mental health. And so this is also an important part, that providing support for the psychosocial well-being of the survivors. So now we will see the types of rehabilitation. What are the types of rehabilitation we need to restore in the process of disaster management? So physical rehabilitation is a very important facet of rehabilitation. It includes reconstruction of physical infrastructure, such as houses, buildings, railways, roads, communication networks, which has been ruptured in the disaster, water supply, electricity, etc. It also comprises short-term, always keep in mind, there is not only short-term goals in physical rehabilitation, we have to take consideration of long-term strategies towards water management, canal irrigation, whatever the physical infrastructure is there, like social forestry, crop stabilization. If we are not taking consideration of economic rehabilitation, then employment generation will and job creation will come under the physical rehabilitation. So always take this point in mind. Crop stabilization and alternative cropping techniques, job creation, employment generation, and environmental protection is very important part. We should not create our long-term strategy, long-term development goals without considering the environmental protection. So it is very important part in physical rehabilitation while considering the physical rehabilitation after disaster. It involves policies for agricultural rehabilitation, rehabilitation of artisans and small businessmen. Actually, in the disaster, small businessmen are affected the most. So we should take consideration of this rehabilitation of artisans and small businessmen as well as rehabilitation of animal husbandry. So you can see the strategies of physical rehabilitation in one look. Reconstruction of physical infrastructure, it will include the houses, buildings, railways, roads, communication networks, water supply, electricity. And if we see the short-term and long-term strategies towards physical rehabilitation, we have to include the watershed management, canal irrigation, social forestry. Social forestry in these days are very important part for the not only for environmental protection and for social forestry and crop stabilization, alternative cropping techniques, job creation. As I had told you that if economic rehabilitation we are not taking in categorizing in different not categorizing it in economic rehabilitation, it will come under the physical rehabilitation, but in short term and long term strategies towards physical rehabilitation, employment generation, environmental protection, and physical rehabilitation strategies includes policies for agricultural rehabilitation, rehabilitation of artisans, small businessmen, and animal husbandry. Physical rehabilitation strategies, you can understand this with this figure also in one look. So we will see now we will see the social rehabilitation processes. So social rehabilitation is also a very important part of disaster recovery, but this dimension is often assumed to be a community function and neglected in most post-disaster programs. As we know that disaster can render some groups such as the elderly, orphans, young girls, single parents with young children, single mothers, etc., much more vulnerable to disaster aftermath due to lack of adequate social support. So we should not ignore these kind of community in this rehabilitation process. So it cannot be ignored. It cannot be neglected in post-disaster programs. So the vulnerable group is, so we should take consideration of vulnerable group as well in the social rehabilitation processes. In the post-disaster phase, family support system can break down. Obviously, family system support system can break down due to physical and mental trauma resulting from losses of life, huge losses of life and property, physical dislocation and migration of some members of disaster affected community. So these vulnerable groups would need special social support. Special social support needs to be given to the survivors so that we can reduce the impact of disaster. Thus, construction of infrastructure such as community centers, daycare centers, Anganwadi, case in these days, Balwadis, and old age homes, etc., is a vital part of social rehabilitation. Actually, these centers can reduce the mental trauma after the disaster in the among the vulnerable groups. So, these social infrastructures are very important, and you can say the vital part of social rehabilitation process. Sir, someone has switched on his mic. Okay. There has to be an adequate provision for building this infrastructure wherever it is non-existent. Means if it is not there in the disaster affected areas, we should establish this in social infrastructure. And if it was there and it has been destroyed, then we should reconstruct the social infrastructures like community centers, daycare centers, old age homes, so or has been destroyed by the disaster. A realistic recovery plan has to take note of this social dimension of the disaster affected area. We should not neglect this social dimension because it's very important part of social rehabilitation in the disaster affected areas. Now we will see the psychological rehabilitation. I have previously discussed about the mental health and mental well-being and the psychological rehabilitation. Now, psychological trauma of losing relatives and friends and the scares of overall shock of the disaster event can take much longer to heal than the stakeholders, planners, such as planners, governmental agency, NGOs, in disaster management often assume. Okay, so psychological trauma is, we always ignore the psychological trauma after the disaster. So it is essential that social welfare and psychological support programs be considered immediately after a disaster event so that they could be made a vital part of recovery programs. Means psychological rehabilitation is a vital part of recovery programs, and we cannot ignore this type of rehabilitation in the disaster management process. No recovery plan can be successful if it does not take consideration of the psychocultural milieu of the affected site. This means that it must give due respect to the tradition. Traditional values, we always ignore the traditional values of the disaster affected communities, their traditional values, their norms, their beliefs, their cultural practices. So we must give in due respect to the cultural practices of the disaster affected communities. And the cultural dimension of recovery plan is most wanting in the areas of housing and shelter, because housing and shelter is part of their cultural belief, how they establish their home, how they make their homes, what kind of facilities they want in their home. And so the cultural dimension we cannot ignore in the area of housing and shelter. Housing designs are imposed. Sometimes it has been seen in the disaster management process that housing designs are imposed. They are not considering the cultural beliefs. They are not considering their traditional norms, traditional beliefs. And housing designs are basically imposed on the victims without taking into consideration their lifestyles, cultural norms and preferences. So it should not be imposed. It should be inconsistent. It should be in relation with their cultural norms, their cultural beliefs and traditional values. A good recovery plan must take a note of these factors. So, for a proper rehabilitation of persons suffering from ill health, there is a need for a systematic epidemiological surveillance and nutrition-centered health assessment to monitor the spread of disease. Sometimes it has been seen that after disaster, the communicable disease is spreading in the community, and it is very hard to handle this situation. So there is need for this systematic surveillance for the monitoring the spread of disease after the disaster. A comprehensive health recovery plan should be in place to deal with the problem of psychological rehabilitation. Means not only the the assessment to monitor the spread of communicable disease, but also we should take in consideration of mental well-being as well. Physical discomfort and illness could have multiple psychological repercussions. Besides, the chances of post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD, you might have heard this name, like post-disaster traumatic stress disorder, are high in disaster aftermath. So we should definitely take in consideration in disaster management process the PTSD, that is called post-traumatic stress disorder, means mental well-being plus monitoring the spread of communicable disease as well. Efforts should be made to arrange for trauma counseling. Sometimes who is suffering from PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, they are not they are not willing to take part in the disaster recovery process because their mental condition is not good. So trauma counseling and panic management is very important, because panic situation in the disaster, after disaster, is really fatal for the disaster management process. So the disaster managers and rehabilitation workers must understand the psychology of the victims at the recovery state and respond accordingly. Means that if we are in disaster management process, if we are understanding the psychology of the victim, their post-traumatic stress disorder, we are considering this, then only the management can be effective at the disaster stage, if they respond according to the psychology of the victims. So priority needs to be accorded to utilizing human resources from the affected areas itself. Like if we are doing a physical rehabilitation, we are in the process of building houses, building community centers, we should utilize human resources from the affected areas itself. And only the expert help should be sought from the external sources. Means if we are involving the human resources from the affected area itself, then what will happen? They can get employment also, and they can engage themselves in recovery process, and so that they can they cannot suffer, they will not be suffering from psychological trauma because they are engaged in some work and they are earning as well. So the only expert help should be sought from external sources, because if communities of the affected areas are not technically skilled or not expert in something, then only we should sought the help from external sources. Otherwise, we should utilize human resources from the affected areas itself. This should be the only priority basis. Now we will discuss the guiding principles of rehabilitation. We will go one by one. First one is treating communities as heterogeneous. Treating communities as heterogeneous means we should not regard the affected communities as a homogeneous group. Means every community is not the same. Every individual, every family is in the affected community, we cannot consider it as a homogeneous group. If we treat communities as heterogeneous, then only we will be giving emphasis on the special care to the special people, like elderly, young girls, and the vulnerable groups. So the need and requirements of the disaster affected community would vary from one group to the other within the community, and also from one individual to the other within the group. Means the need and requirement will vary from not only one group to the other within the community, but it will vary from one individual to the other within the group. Means we cannot treat communities as a homogeneous group. The requirements of affected farmers will be different from small traders. As I had told you, like small farmers and small traders, small business are affected most in the disaster. It's not always true, but most of the time, small traders are affected the most. So, again, the requirements of the children is different, requirement of women is different, requirement of elderly people is different. So, a recovery plan has to prioritize the different requirements and set its objectives accordingly. Second one is striking a balance between economic, social, and psychological need. Just as the needs and requirement of the affected
Hello, ma'am. Sorry to interrupt. Ma'am, we cannot see your slides.
It's not visible, sir.
No, ma'am. Ma'am, जो question ना हुए वहाँ पे resume लिखा हुआ है. आप click करेंगे तो resume होगा. Zoom पे क्लिक करेंगे तो सब स्लाइड देख सकते हैं.
रिज्यूम
आपका जो प्रेजेंट ना हुए वहां पे जाइए. मैम नीचे राइट में होगा प्रेजेंट नाउ आपका.
रिज्यूम योर प्रेजेंटेशन.
हां, रिज्यूम योर प्रेजेंटेशन करेंगे तो सब स्लाइड देख सकते हैं.
और वन मिनट सर. Sir, is it visible?
Yes, ma'am. It is visible.
Okay. Sir, previous slide, which I should start? Okay, sir, is it visible?
Yes, ma'am. Visible.
Okay. So, second one is striking a balance between economic, social, and psychological needs. Just as the needs and requirements of the affected community are largely dependent on what its various groups desire, the economic, social, and psychological needs also vary from one group to the other within the affected community. So we should strike a balance between economic, social, and psychological needs as well. These needs have to be carefully scrutinized. Means we cannot mix these needs in one dimension. Okay, and this satisfaction of one need or requirement does not automatically lead to the satisfaction of other needs. So this is very important to create a balance between economic, social, and psychological needs. For instance, the loss of agricultural land due to a disaster, even though compensated in monetary terms and in terms of new occupational opportunity under rehabilitation, cannot fulfill the psychological loss of being a land owner in the victim. Means if a farmer is land owner in pre-disaster condition, even if we compensate that farmer in monetary terms and in terms of new occupational opportunity given to them, this cannot fulfill the psychological loss of being a land owner in the victim. So we need to because nostalgia is added to that ancestral place that cannot be overcome easily. So psychological counseling of these kind of land owners is very necessary. So if we have socially rehabilitated them and economically we have compensated them, but his psychological needs should be fulfilled. Like their psychological counseling is necessary because nostalgia is added to the that ancestral place that cannot be overcome easily. This reality is a part of the social status as well. Means their social status, they were the landowner and now they don't have land. They are engaged in some other occupational activities which is not, maybe they are not liking, but they have received it just because of compensation of monetary loss. So established livelihood, social relations, social status, kinship, etc. are sources of satisfaction. As any change or blockage, even though temporary, towards fulfillment of these needs results in varying degree of tensions and stress in different people. Means any change, definitely after disaster, lots of changes are there, and even if that changes are temporary towards fulfillment of these needs result in varying degree of stress in different people. So we should take consideration of these aspects as well. A good recovery plan must not lose sight of these aspects. Recovery actions can be therapeutic in assisting the victims to rebuild their lives and livelihood if they are contextual and rooted in local values. So we should take consideration of these aspects also. Likewise, they also need to strike a clear balance between the different types of requirements of victims. We should categorize the requirements of victims, different types of requirements of victims, then only we can strike a balance between the different types of needs like economic, social, and psychological needs. Encouraging flexibility and adaptiveness. A recovery plan has to be adaptive in nature. Adaptive in nature means we should be always ready for plan B. Means a recovery plan, if we have made a plan A, it is not working. So plan has to be adaptive in nature. Like means if plan A is not working, we can switch on plan B so that it can change as per the demands of the new situation. Because this after disaster, the situation is really unpredictable. So we should always ready for the plan B, and our recovery plan should be adaptive in nature so that it can change as per the demands of new situation arises. So flexibility norms in terms of structure, process, and finances needs to be ingrained in the plan. Means flexibility norms not in, only in terms of a structure, if you are structuring something, a structural process, and in terms of structure, process, and financial situation needs to be ingrained in the plan. Disaster management needs a strong political commitment. Means if we are not in coordination with planning and implementation activities, then we cannot effectively manage the disaster process, the after disaster effects. So a process with a clearly defined authority as well as an appropriate budget to maintain an effective disaster plan is needed. Means clearly a process with a clearly defined authority means and appropriate budget so that we can maintain an effective disaster plan. Fourth one is promoting systematic damage assessment. Actually, damage assessment is what? We are assessing the damage. Means, what is damaged and what will be the short-term recovery goal, what will be the long-term recovery goal. It can only be done after a good disaster assessment. Disaster assessment has been done. So disaster assessment is a precondition for effective disaster management, you can say. Unless we are clear about the nature, extent and intensity of damage in the aftermath of disaster, we can never plan out, implement or evaluate the disaster management plans and strategies. Means if we are not clear about the nature and intensity of damage, if we are not aware of the intensity of the damage in the aftermath of disaster, how can we plan and implement and evaluate the disaster management plan and strategy? So it's very important part that systematic damage assessment is necessary. So the thus the recovery plan can also be ill-conceived. Ill-conceiving of disaster effect is very fatal for this systematic damage assessment. So disaster the recovery plan can never be we cannot made a recovery plan which is ill-conceived. So there is a need for a methodical damage assessment so that the strategies of livelihood creation and infrastructure development are incorporated in recovery plan. Okay, livelihood creation for the disaster affected communities and infrastructure which has been destroyed in the disaster, and so and infrastructure development so that it can not only achieve the we can not only achieve the short term goals but it can long achieve the we can achieve the long term strategies goal as well. So it should be incorporated in the recovery plan. Fifth one is supporting transparency, efficiency and effectiveness. Means transparency is very important. The recovery plan must be clear, structured in well structured manner. Objective should be clear, what we are going to do. Steps of work is called objective. So it should be very clear. Accessible, accountable means accountability should be there, because without accountability we cannot imagine the transparency in the plan, and it should be responsive. So this is possible if transparency is maintained at each level of recovery plan. Continuous monitoring and evaluation could ensure transparent, efficient and effective plans. Means if we are not accountability is not there and clear objective is not there and plan is not well structured and not clear, we cannot imagine the transparency in the disaster management plans. So the basic objective of monitoring and evaluation exercise is to ensure whether the project is proceeding as originally intended. Means always monitoring should be there for the if plan is working according to our objective or not. We should always monitor it time to time. In case of post-disaster exercise, monitoring and evaluation could strive to check if all the rehabilitation needs of the affected victims are being met or not. means we should always monitor that what we have planned, what we have decided, the steps of work, objectives. It is fulfilling the rehabilitation needs of the affected victims or not. Always monitoring should be there. It could follow the SMART. SMART means specific, measurable, attainable. Goals should be attainable. It should be relevant and time-bound. Time-bound is very important because if it is specific plan, it should be time-bound and relevant to the disaster management plan. And it should be measurable and attainable as well. This is the tool of indicators. In short, I have written it's SMART, which have to be set at the planning for recovery stage itself. Viability of a disaster recovery policy depends on responsible monitoring and review. Told you earlier that a responsible monitoring is very important, and review of the plan. If it is, we have implemented some plan in the study area, but it is working, we are not monitoring whether it is working or not. Plan B is required or not. If plan A is working or not, the review is not there. We cannot imagine the well-managed disaster management plan. So a good recovery plan should strive towards the guiding principles. This as we are discussing the guiding principles of rehabilitation. Ensuring financial recovery is very important part, that rehabilitation is that of infrastructure development, which largely depends on financial support. If we are not getting financial support, we cannot properly develop the infrastructure in the disaster affected areas. Governments at the central level as well as state levels have specific schemes and strategies for providing funds. Sometimes we are not aware of about the plans which are running by the central government and the state government. So provide funds for disaster management activities is very important, with relief, rehabilitation and reconstruction also. The calamity relief fund is one such arrangement at the central level in India. Other financial arrangements include National Calamity Contingency Fund, Prime Minister's National Relief Fund, and Member of Parliament Local Area District Scheme. Even the insurance scheme could be regarded as an important source for resource generation. This is also, for example, schemes such as Swarn Jayanti, Gram Swarojgar Yojana, update this data about this, what I have written in these slides. Go to the sites and update your data. National Agricultural Insurance, Seed Crop Insurance, and Kisan Credit Card, etc., should be encouraged as practicable option of disaster mitigation. There are some UN agencies as well, like WHO, UNICEF, UNESCO, World Food Programme, International Labour Organization, United Nations Population Fund, and also the International Monetary Fund, as well as the World Bank, working through International Development Association, International Finance Corporation, Multilateral Investment Guarantee Agency, can also provide legitimacy to recovery process and encourage donors to provide finances and seed capital for the disaster recovery projects. These are the UN agency which can help in the disaster recovery projects. Developing disaster resistant buildings means physical rehabilitation calls for construction of disaster resistant structure. Means it should not be like temporary. It should be disaster resistant. And retrofitting of existing ones to make them disaster. If existing physical infrastructure in the disaster prone area is there, we can make it disaster resistant. Different type of resistance component will have to go into earthquake resistant, cyclone resistant, or in cyclone prone areas, in earthquake earthquake prone areas, flood prone areas, we can develop the flood resistant structures, earthquake resistant structures, cyclone resistant structures. A recovery plan should have adequate provision for building disaster resistant structure as a guiding principle. We are discussing about the guiding principle, so we should take these points in the guiding principle also. Building resilient communities. No rehabilitation package can succeed without taking into view the psychology of those affected by the disaster. Means we have to understand the psychology of the disaster community which is affected in the disaster, in the disaster prone area. Human psyche comes into play at every stage of disaster management cycle, be it mitigation, rescue and relief, or reconstruction and rehabilitation. A participatory means a participation of community which is affected in the disaster. Their participation is very important. Means a participatory disaster recovery program that involves the local people, civil society organizations and grassroots agencies at the decision making and implementation stages would go a very long way in shaping a more human and feasible disaster rehabilitation program. Means participatory approach is very important. If we are promoting the disaster affected communities, disaster affected community in participation in the disaster recovery process, then it will go a long way in shaping the more feasible disaster rehabilitation program. Means participatory approach is community participation is very important. So in one look, you can see the major strategies for building resilient communities, like community participation is important. I had discussed it. Education and training. Education and training means if some area is disaster prone, like if it is cyclone prone, earthquake prone, we should always give them education and training about that. To not involve that community in panic situation. We can save them from panic situation. If panic situation is arising, they can handle their mental stress, they can handle their situation, they can save their family, save their friends as well. So education and training of the community is very important. Stress management. Stress management is the only way to avoid the panic situation after disaster. So stress management skills should be there in the disaster affected communities. We should always make a plan for the for educating them for stress management, and the positive role of media is very important. Like you can see the positive role is of media in the communicable disease like COVID-19 in the current global pandemic. You can see the positive role of media, how people are without creating gathering, we can spread the message as possible, more people. We are spreading effective messages to people without gatherings in become disaster affected areas. So positive role of media is very important in building resilient communities. Ninth is upholding the norms of equity and social justice. Social equity is very important. Some disasters often hit, as I had told you, like it's most of the time it has been seen that disaster affects the least developed areas, because most vulnerable physical infrastructure is there, and the most disadvantaged group hit the hardest. Rehabilitation and reconstruction programs should aim to change the vulnerable condition of the high-risk population through development programs. Means we should take consideration of vulnerable condition of high-risk population, because it most of the time it hit the least developed areas and most disadvantaged groups. there is a need for a more human paradigm of disaster management. Like, we should not always keep in mind that reconstructing the physical infrastructure, building the houses, building the shelters. There is a need for a more human paradigm of disaster management. The goals of equity, justice, and balanced development have to be ingrained in the disaster management policy right at the outset. Respecting traditional wisdom, I have discussed in previous slide that recovery process should not be forced on the community which is affected in the disaster. Respecting traditional wisdom is very important. It should not be imposed. We should always respect their cultural norms and values. Even though we have a tradition of living in harmony with nature, this balance is being disturbed in the present context. People have always followed traditional practices of coping with disaster, because if some area is disaster affected, disaster prone, there must be some traditional practices. We should always follow that traditional practices also. We should always keep in mind that traditional practices also, because but we are becoming too dependent on the external agencies, because sometimes external agencies are doing the external agency generalize the condition disaster aftermath, because so now this time has come to respect the traditional wisdom, because if we are following the traditional practices, we can definitely this will not be imposed on the disaster affected community. It will be in harmony with their traditional practices. Traditional practices of water conservation, such as Kuls of Himachal Pradesh, this is the traditional practices they do for water conservation in Himachal Pradesh, because water scarcity is there in Himachal Pradesh. Kundis and Rapats of Rajasthan and Paliyas of Kerala have held people in good stead against low intensity droughts. Because as you all know, that drought is the very first on among the disaster, like drought. So we should always take in consideration of these traditional practices, because these previous is like Kundis and Rapta schools have held people in good stead against low intensity droughts. Sumers and Chaukhats of Rajasthan are earthquake resistant structure from our rich heritage. So we should know the techniques of the Sumers and Chaukhats, how they make it, because these are the earthquake resistant structures. These traditional practices are being abandoned to make way for new technologies, because if we are adopting the new technologies, then these traditional practices are being ignored. So we should not ignore these traditional practices, because these are coming from the long back of. So we should always take consideration of their traditional structures also. At the time when we need a thoughtful amalgam of the old and the new, means the seer blend of new and old, we are slowly losing our traditional wisdom to a haphazard approach to modern technology. We should adopt the modern technology, but in harmony with the old practices of disaster resistant structures. A systematic recovery plan should make way for a right mix of traditional practices. Means this should be a sheer blend of right mix of traditional practices, modern way of living, and technological development also. So a systematic recovery plan should make a right mix of these three practices. 11th is endorsing sustainable development and alternative livelihood strategies. Means sustainable development is important. In order to create long-term vulnerability reduction conditions, a sustainable livelihood framework is urgently required. We are developing haphazard manner, but we are not taking consideration of sustainable development. So we should endorse sustainable development and alternative livelihood strategies also in the recovery process. The livelihood approach advocates an increase in economic opportunity of work without degrading the natural environment. It seeks to understand the many factors influencing people's choice of livelihood strategy and reinforcing their constraints. Creation of livelihood option is a crucial component of community vulnerability reduction. Community vulnerability reduction, we can only reduce the community vulnerability with creation of livelihood options. It is an important step towards capacity building also, capacity building of the community. So we will go for the, now we will go for the, to understand the interlinkages between recovery and development. So first I would like to introduce, like, the disaster recovery stage in disaster management cycle falls between the disaster response phase and the overall development phase. So thus, so it is necessary that vital interlinkages between all the three phases be established. This could be achieved through systematic planning and implementation of a long-term recovery program in the disaster aftermath. Rehabilitation and reconstruction operations are integral to disaster recovery. They provide a direct connect between disaster response and long-term development. The two activities, however, do not have similar connotation. Rehabilitation involves restoring local services related to the provision of immediate needs. Means rehabilitation not only involves the restoring local services, it is also related to the provision of immediate needs. It implies a systematic return to pre-disaster status. It refers, to interlinkages between recovery process and rehabilitation and reconstruction processes. So disaster can seriously degrade a country's long-term potential for sustained development and cause governments to sustain substantially modify their economic and social priorities as well as development programs. Disaster often force the otherwise stable sedentary population to move away from their established places of work and create psychological stress, leading to many dysfunctional consequences. Yet, they do highlight high-risk areas where action must be taken before another disaster strikes. So, in the present context, disaster can no longer be viewed as a random occurrence caused by nature. Means, now the development activities are so high, so that in the present context we cannot see the disaster as the occurrence caused by nature that it was previously viewed, but in the present context it is not no more reliable, so no more actually relevant. The distinction between natural and man-made disaster is getting blurred with time. Means natural, if we say the earthquake, then it is not distinctly different from the man-made disaster and natural disaster. That's why I have written that distinction between the natural and man-made disaster is getting blurred with time. Means we are responsible for the induction of natural disasters. So the frequency and intensity of disasters have recorded an all-time high as the harmonious balance between human beings and nature has been disturbed to almost irreparable proportion. Means nature has been disturbed to that context which has come to the situation of irreparable proportions. Faulty urbanization, haphazard development in urbanization, population explosion, civil strife, unbalanced industrial growth are the reasons attributed to environmental degradation characterized by global warming, deforestation, desertification, social erosion, and so on. So we are, that's why I had said that the distinction between natural and man-made disaster is really getting blurred with time. Environmental degradation and mismanagement may aggravate the frequency, severity, and predictability of hazard. If we are degrading the environmental to that context and mismanaging it, then definitely it will aggravate the frequency, severity, and predictability of hazard. It could be behind the increased instances of disasters. Disaster management has to placed in context to the developmental challenges, means disaster management should be in harmony with developmental challenges that the country faces as a whole. There is a significant relationship in the way that disasters and development affect one another. Means developmental activities and disaster have a significant relationship, and these are affecting each other. While disasters are catastrophic events, lessons learned incorporated into long-term means if we are learning a lesson from the catastrophic events, we should definitely incorporate that lessons into long-term development planning, which can serve to reduce future vulnerability. The destruction of unsafe infrastructure and buildings can provide a means if in disaster prone areas some infrastructure is destructing, we can relook, we can reconsider that for rebuilding that infrastructure with better standards. We should, there are some standards, international standards, national standards for building infrastructure in the disaster prone areas. There are different standards for different type of disaster prone areas, like cyclone affected areas, earthquake affected areas, drought prone areas, and heavy rain areas. So we should reconsider and rebuild that infrastructure with better standards. Means lesson learning is very important. If we are going to make an interlinkage between disaster recovery process and development with developmental process also. So relocation to a better place. Relocation of that infrastructure to a better place, which is not destruction prone, if the present site is found specifically vulnerable. Particularly, damaging disaster will also focus on relief and rehabilitation investment, thus providing developmental opportunities that were previously unavailable. Means, we can learn in the recovery process and rehabilitation process, and we can provide which can provide the developmental opportunity that that were previously not there or not available in that area. Damaged building may highlight structural weaknesses. If some building is getting damaged, so definitely we can highlight the structural weaknesses of that damaged building, which could be rectified and may serve to improve building and planning regulations. We should not leave that damaged structures without learning a lessons and without highlighting the structural weaknesses, and we should rectify that, and which can definitely serve to improve planning regulation in the near future. Adequate linkages between disasters and development can, for example, reduce the vulnerability of coastal communities to natural hazards by establishing a regional early warning system. Like if tsunami, in tsunami warning system, you have heard this name of tsunami warning system. So we should make a linkage between the disaster and development. Like we can reduce the vulnerability of coastal communities to national hazards by establishing a regional early warning system, which can spread the warning as soon as possible. Applying construction setbacks, green belts, and other no-built areas, because sometimes we ignore these standards like green belts, construction setbacks, and no rebuild the structures in the no-build areas also. So this we should apply these standards, norms. We should follow these norms to reduce the disaster and reduce the effect of disaster and make a link, interlinkage between disaster recovery, disaster recovery process and developmental goals. Promote early resettlement with provision for safe housing, debris clearance, potable water, sanitation. Sanitation is very important. Drainage services, because drainage services sometimes you had that blockage of drainage system can cause like Mumbai rain. You have in 2010 probably, I don't remember the year, but in Mumbai rain you have seen the blockage of drainage system has caused what kind of condition in that area, and access to sustainable livelihood options. Enhance the ability of the natural system to act as biosafe. We are degrading the natural system in that way, which is no longer serving us as a bioseal, which were previously working as a bioseal to protect us, protect people, and restoring wetlands, mangroves, spawning areas, seagrass beds, and coral reefs. And by we can enhance this by seeking alternative building designs that is not only cost effective but appropriate and consistent as well. It has to be seen as to how the interlinkages between disaster and development could be incorporated in disaster recovery plan. Means our topic is like that, like disaster recovery and developmental goals. Means we should always keep in mind that how we see, how we make interlinkages between disaster and development and in the disaster recovery process. We should not make that disaster recovery plan in that manner that it cannot meet the developmental goals. Rehabilitation and reconstruction phase is the most opportune time to rebuild infrastructure. Means rehabilitation process, reconstruction process in the disaster recovery phase gives us the opportunity to relook in the infrastructure, rebuild the damaging which is going to be damaged in the near future, rebuild the infrastructure, resources and community, because it is not only the rehabilitation and reconstruction phase for the particular disaster, but it also gives us opportunity and opportunity to rebuild the infrastructure, resources and communities. Means recovery plans would encompass the issues related to negative impact of disasters on socio-economic systems and the ways and means through which these challenges could be converted into development or developmental opportunities. Means I want to say that recovery plan should make in that manner which can meet the, we can means like we can convert disaster into opportunity, as we have seen, we have heard this slogan in the recent pandemic. We should convert the disaster into opportunity to rebuild, relook in the weaknesses, and so that we can convert that into developmental opportunities. We have moved on from post-disaster assistance to pre-disaster preparedness. Means, this time has come to prepare. Pre-disaster preparedness is more important than post-disaster assistance. Post-disaster assistance is important, but we are moving on from post-disaster assistance to pre-disaster preparedness, from readiness to mitigation, from individual act to restoration of services, and from relief to rehabilitation. Means temporary relief is not important. How we are making the rehabilitation plan, long-term plan, not only short-term plan, but long-term plan of rehabilitation is very important. That's why I said from relief to rehabilitation. So, So a broad disaster recovery plan should include comprehensive sub plans on these following points: health and medical care. It is a broad points I have listed it. Health and medical care, creation of livelihood options, environmental protection, rehabilitation and reconstruction. Not only relief, but a long-term rehabilitation and reconstruction planning. Health and medical care is important. Creation of livelihood options, because if we are engaging the communities in creation of livelihood, they can only be then only they can feel they can they cannot feel the psychological stress and economical stress also. So the main line of interlinkages between development and recovery process is the interlinkages between all the stages of disaster, means pre disaster condition, post phase and structural process. The interlinkages between all the stages of disaster management cycle, as well as between disasters and development, have to be recognized and assimilated in the disaster recovery plan. This is the this was the last point, but I will give you some idea about the interlinkages between rehabilitation, reconstruction and developmental processes. So these rehabilitation and reconstruction operations are integral to disaster recovery. They provide a direct connect between disaster response and long-term development goals. The two activities, however, do not have similar connotation. Rehabilitation involves restoring local services, not only local services, but it is also related to provision of immediate needs. It implies a systematic return to pre-disaster status. It refers to actions taken in the aftermath of disaster to enable basic services to resume functioning, assist victims, self-help efforts to repair physical, not only physical damage, but restore community facilities, as I had shown you in the previous slides, like Anganwadi, creche, and your old age homes, assist victims and community facilities, and revive economic activities, and provide support for the psychological and social well-being of the survivors. Very important: repairing physical damage, restoring community facilities, revive economic activities, and provide support for the psychological and social well-being of the survivors. It focuses on enabling the affected population to resume more or less normal patterns of life. It may be considered as a transitional phase between immediate relief and major long-term development goal. But reconstruction, on the other hand, represents long-term development assistance, which could help people in the affected areas to rebuild their life and meet their present, and not only present, always keep in mind, it should meet the future needs as well. It takes into account reduction of future disaster risks. Rehabilitation may not necessarily restore the damaged structure and resources in their previous form or location. It may include the replacement of temporary arrangements established as a part of your emergency response, or the upgradation of infrastructure and systems from pre-disaster status. For example, following a damaging hurricane, you know, this is a super cyclone, the rehabilitation of the power lines would aim to restore the system as rapidly as possible, so that the essential services would continue to function. Whereas this reconstruction of power lines would aim to rebuild the rehabilitated system to a higher or safer standard than before, so that the future risk to the power lines from a similar damaging event could be reduced. Means what I have said, the reconstruction must be fully integrated into long-term development plans. Means it should be in harmony with long-term development plan. Preparedness is important. Taking into account future disaster risks and possibilities to reduce them, by incorporating appropriate measures. As we have mentioned before in the previous slide, the term recovery is used to embrace both the rehabilitation and reconstruction activities also. Both the activities may be required in the aftermath of disaster. One does not essentially exclude the other. Thank you. Enough for today. Any questions?
Thank you, madam. Actually, there are some certain questions are there. So there's a question. Siddhi Pratha Panda, he has requested that madam at the end please present all the slides one more time. Yesterday he has also made some requests with regards to your presentation. Okay, Siddhi Pratha Panda, we will also making all the efforts. I would request madam to send all the PPTs so that we can place it in our website and you can also go through it. And if required, we can also send you through your email also. So,
okay, sir, I will
send. Question. What? Yes, ma'am.
Okay, sir, I will share the slide.
Okay, okay. Yeah. His question, what is the difference between a recovery and a rehabilitation? And also, what are the similarities?
Recovery is a phase. Actually, this is the phase of disaster management cycle. And rehabilitation, reconstruction, and short-term and long-term development goals are the process within it. Rehabilitation process, reconstruction process, physical rehabilitation. Physical rehabilitation, types of rehabilitation I have discussed in this slide. Physical rehabilitation, social rehabilitation, and this is the part of that recovery stage. So recovery is a phase, and these are the parts of that recovery stage in the disaster management cycle. Yeah?
Yes, if anyone has any more questions, they can directly ask the question. If they were interested, they can write here or they can ask the question. I just want to just conclude in a nutshell that 2 days madam has taken to guide you all regarding disaster management. When we are discussing on disaster management, it starts from your word disaster. So I am not going to connote or give a proper definition how it was found and when it was found. Let me give you an idea that when disaster becomes more disastrous, then we think over this kind of disaster management. So what she has said or what she has given you guidance from last 2 days, so disaster management cycle is such, it's a vicious cycle. It is very much continuous, and you know, you will find this condition. Yesterday I have told you all earlier that this is very fascinating condition, that you are unable to find out the position, which one is pre-disaster, which one is in the during disaster position, and which one is the post-disaster position. So basically what happened, as there is a quotation or is a proverb, everyone is gone through it, prevention is always better than cure. So in same condition, pre-disaster is some kind of risk reduction phase. It can be considered to be a preventional phase or it's a risk reduction phase. Then it comes to you during disaster phase, where you will find the impact of disasters. You will directly feel the impact of disasters in this during disaster phase. Then it comes to your post-disaster phase, where this is called to be a complete recovery or reconstructional or redevelopment phase. So basically what the definitions have been connoted or defined in pre-disaster, this is a disaster, it is a phase before a disaster. It is to reduce the potential for human, material or environmental losses caused by hazards to ensure that these losses are minimized when the disaster actually strikes. So it is the preventive measures we have to take in pre-disaster condition. When it comes to your during disaster condition, that is out of your control. This is not in the control of the what you call the human control is not there. If it is not at all a man-made disaster, it is the phase where you have to ensure that the needs and provision for victims should be met, and it should create or minimize the suffering, so that we can take proper initiative. It will create and minimize suffering. Then the third phase, it is the post-disaster. That is when after disaster has occurred, we have to take some rapid and durable recovery activities so that we should produce original vulnerable conditions. So, sorry. In this process, first we are considering prevention, then it goes, if it happens, we have to immediately take immediate steps to mitigate. How to mitigate this kind of problems and this kind of disaster issues, we have to take mitigation. Then it comes to a complete preparedness. A planning has to be made and initiative has to be taken up for preparedness. In the process of preparedness, it is also a position is there to how you are going to respond, how you are having a proper response in those activities, that what you have to take, how much initiative you have to take, what kind of first aid you have to take, food is required, shelter is required, there is some amount of proper temporary shelters are required, some permanent shelters are required. Then it comes to your recovery, as madam has said just now, the question of the Siddhipitha Panda. So in recovery and rehabilitation is more or less is a very common phenomena, but the thing is that rehabilitation is the immediate initiative, immediate step you have to take to go for a long-term process of recovery. Rehabilitated means immediately, a person is going to die in a medical or hospital, so suddenly doctor comes out and he will say he has recovered. He is not going to say he's rehabilitated. He has recovered. Recovered means his life has been secured and he has got his life. So recovery is a long-term process and it needs some amount of proper reconstruction, redevelopmental activities. Then only you will consider this has been completely recovered. For reaching to the phase of recovery, you have to go through the different phases of rehabilitation. It may be physical rehabilitation, it may be sometimes natural rehabilitation as well. So some initiative have been taken through rehabilitation. That means, for example, you are getting someone who was there for the cyclonic activity zone. You will get him to the temporary shelter area. You will provide them food. You will provide them clothing, shelter, all these things. This is immediate initiative you have taken, in immediate steps you have taken to rehabilitate. But this is not the right kind of recovery for him or her. For recovery, he needs a permanent shelter. He needs a permanent, services. He needs a permanent employment opportunity. So these are the phases where you require all kind of steps to be taken up altogether. Sometimes administrative initiatives are required. Sometimes, media initiative, positive news, as just madam has told you all, that this COVID-19 will be more fatal, will be more dangerous if the news or the negative news will come out, creating havoc in the mindset of the learners or viewers. So here the role of the presenters in the news channels or the persons those are dealing directly with the patients, they should be very positive in their mind because their statements, their views, makes a difference with the commoners, with the persons, those who are viewing or learning about the issue. So it is some way very much important that proper coordination, proper mindset, proper initiative should be in a completely, in such a phase, it will create emergency relief, it will create rehabilitation, it will create reconstruction to the mindset. Physically, we are requiring the replacement of buildings, with regards to some kind of earthquake or cyclone, where you will have a proper replacement of building. This is called, physical initiative we have to take. Infrastructure or lifeline facilities has to come into the mainstream to give the long-term developmental prospects. But with regards to let it be a biological disaster just like COVID-19, here you require more psychological and soothing statements, psychological and socio-psychological initiatives to be taken up to give more comfort to the patients, to the commoners, because here you are not going to go through the physical development or physical support. Rather, you require some amount of psychological support so that it is giving soothing statements or comfortable. Creating comfortable zone to the people, those who are learning this kind of COVID. Yesterday, someone is asking about this COVID, what we are taking, what initiative should we take. It is interesting to learn that after, it is more than, it was started in the month of March, now it is July. It is more than 4 months. Yesterday, the Government of Odisha Women and Child Development Department has given a very much proactive and perfect guidelines, strategies they have made, how you have to take immediate short-term initiatives to get proper recovery from this COVID-19. Okay. However, I'm thankful to Madam for this detailed discussion and the very clarifications she has made with regards to all the statements and all the with all the learners. And finally, I'm also thankful to the participant, to the coordination team, Mr. Debasis Barik, who is coordinating from both the end, to Madam, who is there in the university, and with the learners from different parts of the state. Okay, Madam, thank you very much. You want to say something? Do you want to say something?
No, sir. Thank you. I have to.
Okay, thank you. Okay, Devasis, now we can wind up the session.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Thank you all.